Well, good morning, church family. My name is JC Minton, and I'll be leading our time and reading our passage this morning, and we'll be in Luke chapter 21, verses 25 through 38. And you may have noticed that we've been starting to do this more often, and I just want to share just briefly the heart behind why we want to implement this time in our Sunday gathering. For one, we see this as a continuation of our time in worship as we read God's word together, as we do what God's people and God's church have done for many generations, as we devote ourselves to the public reading of God's word. And as Jason Bradshaw said a few weeks ago, we just want to be a church that is deeply rooted in God's word. And so you'll begin to see members of our body, brothers and sisters, come up and lead this time. And our hope is that it is encouraging and edifying to us as this local body. And so with that being said, I want to continue our time in worship as we read God's word. Again, we're in Luke chapter 21, verses 25 through 38. There will be signs in sun and moon and stars, and on the earth dismay among nations, in perplexity at the roaring of the sea and the waves. Men fainting from fear and the expectation of the things which are coming upon the world, for the powers of the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. But when these things begin to take place, straighten up and lift up your heads, because your redemption is drawing near. Then he told them a parable. Behold the fig tree and all the trees. As soon as they put forth leaves, you see it and know for yourselves that summer is now near. So you also, when you see these things happening, recognize that the kingdom of God is near. Truly I say to you, this generation will not pass away until all things take place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. Be on guard so that your hearts will not be weighted down with dissipation and drunkenness and the worries of life, and that day will not come on you suddenly like a trap. For it will come upon all those who dwell on the face of all the earth. But keep on the alert at all times, praying that you may have strength to escape all these things that are about to take place and to stand before the Son of Man. Now during the day he was teaching in the temple, but at evening he would go out and spend the night on the mount that is called Olivet. And all the people would get up early in the morning to come to him in the temple to listen to him.
Let's pray together. Father, as we look to hear from you this morning, we ask for your help in understanding this word. Father, you tell us that faith is the assurance of things hoped for and the conviction of things unseen. So Father, we ask that this morning you would give us the eyes of faith, that in some measure we would be able to behold that which is far beyond our imagination, but yet you give us a glimpse of through your word and through the passages we'll look at this morning. And indeed, Father, by your Spirit allowing us to see these things with the eyes of faith, would you indeed fill us with wonder, awestruck wonder at the mention of your name. We pray these things in the name of Christ. Amen. Well, this morning, if you have your Bible with you, and I hope you do, will you, in addition to Luke 21, will you go ahead and mark Revelation chapter 6, what Jesus is going to prophesy here in Luke chapter 21, the second half of it. The Apostle John later expounds further upon for us in Revelation chapter 6 to help us see that vision a little bit more. And so we're gonna be in both places. If you remember back from last week, we talked about the destruction of Jerusalem and how there were signs that were leading up to what was going to occur, how it was going to be God's judgment upon this regional area for their rejection of the Messiah. And when we talked about prophecy, we talked about the near and the far, and how really what Jesus is setting his disciples up to do in this first century context and for us today is he's setting us up not to be fearful about the future, but to anticipate its arrival. Because for those who are outside of Christ, though that arrival of the future is going to bring judgment, for us, it's going to bring the fullness of our redemption and our salvation, the full arrival of the kingdom of God and the new heavens and the new earth. And what we're going to see in this passage is Jesus talking to his disciples, and he's telling them to stand up straight and to lift your face so that they might behold with the eyes of faith that is to come. And in doing so, that would give them the strength to endure today. But we talked about how history is going to unfold towards this as we see these signs approaching, that it's going to progressively speed up in anticipation. We slow clapped last week. Remember that? And so to prepare us for the anticipation of what's coming, let's slow clap this passage in as well. You ready? Let me hear it. There we go. You ready for what's coming for you at the end of that in history? We're about to find out. The main idea this morning, you're going to see it's this phrase, stand, show up in multiple places that we're going to look at. But the main idea is this: standing before the Son of Man by faith. Standing before the Son of Man by faith. The outline that we'll go through as we look through this passage is that predictors that we see, that when is this time coming for the return of Christ? Promises. What are the promises for those who are in Christ when this day arrives? And then practical advice, which is really is then, as we await with the eyes of faith and confidence and our ability to stand when he comes, how then should we live today? And Jesus tells us at the very end of this passage. And so we're going to look at these together. So let's start with the predictors. This is the second half of Jesus' prophecy in Luke 21. He's transitioned from talking about the destruction of the temple and of the city of Jerusalem that happened later after this prophecy in AD 70. And now he's looking all the way to the end of time, to the return of Christ. And what are these signs of this tribulation that's going to come, that are going to precede his coming? And what will its effect be upon the earth? And this is what he says in Luke 21, 25 through 26. He says, "There will be signs in sun and moon and stars, and on earth dismay among the nations. In perplexity at the roaring of the sea and the waves, men fainting from fear and the expectation of things which are coming upon the world, for the powers of the heavens will be shaken." So to try to, as best as we can, imagine that moment, what this is talking about is really an unraveling of creation. Whereas the creation account, when we look at it, we see as God begins to create, it starts in this state of chaos, but then from that chaos, God brings order. He hangs the stars in the heavens. He divides the waters from the land. He then fills the earth with inhabitants of animals and birds and fish, and then the pinnacle of all, which is humanity itself. And so you see this progressive order being brought to creation. What Jesus is talking about in this passage, as we get closer to the end of time and really enter the immediate signs leading up to his return, we're actually going to see instead of going from order to chaos, from chaos to order, we're going to see things go from order back unto chaos. And a part of that is really going to be, we're going to start to see things like the waters begin to overtake the earth. That's what it's talking about in here. You're going to begin to see global earthquakes that are shifting the foundation of the world as we know it. It talks about the sky itself beginning, the celestial sky beginning to fall upon us. And so it's this picture. If you've ever seen any movie about the end of the world, okay, not the alien kind, but like the world itself is falling apart, that is the image, in some sense, that Jesus is painting for us here. And then he goes on, what he's going to say is, at this juncture between heaven and earth passing away, this earth that we know, and the arrival of the new heaven and new earth, at this juncture of time is the final judgment. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 24 says, "It's appointed for man to die once, and after this comes judgment." Here is that judgment, when all will come before God. And the big question is, who will be able to stand? And we're going to see what those who have rejected God at this time will say and how they respond to what's before them. But what Jesus talks about here in Luke 21 is given further definition for us in Revelation chapter 6, verses 12 through 14. So turn there with me. In the book of Revelation, this great tribulation period is given further definition in terms of what's going to occur through these signs of seven seals, seven trumpets, and seven bowls. They're kind of all describing this progressive unraveling of creation as judgment comes in. And in the sixth seal in particular, which is this passage we're looking at, it very much mirrors Jesus' words in Luke chapter 21. So look at what it says here. It says, "I looked when he broke the sixth seal, and there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth made of hair, and the whole moon became like blood, and the stars of the sky fell to the earth, as a fig tree casts its unripe figs when shaken by a great wind. And the sky was split apart like a scroll when it is rolled up, and every mountain and island were moved out of their places." This is describing the end of the world and the passing away of this earth. And you can imagine, I mean, if we think about a hurricane or an earthquake or a tornado that comes through and the damage that can occur and the terror that can bring upon people, imagine that on a global scale simultaneously occurring. It's going to strike terror in the hearts of people. And what Jesus is saying is when you begin to see these global cataclysmic events, it is at this time when I will return. And in verse 27 in Luke is when he says, "Then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory." This time, what we're going to see is that Jesus is not coming as an infant, as the Lamb of God who comes to take away the sins of the world, but rather he comes as a conquering king to bring God's vengeance upon evil and God's judgment upon sin. And when the skies roll back like a scroll in Revelation 19, it describes Jesus as coming down on a white horse with his eyes like a flame of fire, his robe dipped in blood, a sword proceeding from his mouth. And he returns with the armies of heavens to bring about God's judgment on the nations and to tread out the winepress of the fierce wrath of God on all who have rejected him. So you can imagine that on this day when that occurs, the terror that begins to fill all the people. And it says back in Revelation 6, to go back to that passage after the signs, it gives this description of how all those who are on the earth at the time who have rejected Jesus will respond in that day. And this is what it says. "Then the kings of the earth and the great men and the commanders and the rich and the strong and every slave and free man, from the least to the greatest, all who presently stand and shake their fist and mock God." This is what's going to happen when these signs begin to unfold. "They will hide themselves in the caves and among the rocks of the mountains. And they will say to the mountains and to the rocks, 'Fall on us and hide us from the presence of him who sits on the throne, for they are terrified, and from the wrath of the Lamb, for the great day of their wrath has come.'" And then they ask this question as they see these things unfolded, as they behold the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords returning, they will ask the question, "And who is able to stand?" Who is able to stand in the presence of this one who is the holy, holy, holy Lord God Almighty? And in that moment, they will cease their mocking and they will cease their scoffing, and that they will know that they deserve that wrath and judgment being poured out upon them for their rejection of the very God who is coming back. That's the predictors that Jesus gives of what's going to happen leading up to in the midst of his return to judge the nations. But there is an answer to the question, who is able to stand before this King of Kings and Lord of Lords when he returns? And the answer to that question is all those who have taken refuge and who have been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb of God who came to take away the sins of the world. Amen? And in that same Revelation passage, if you keep reading and you go from chapter 6 when you see the response of the unbelieving world, Jesus in chapter 7 lifts our eyes up and gives us a vision into the throne room of God. And this is what it says in Revelation 7. After these things I looked, and behold, a great multitude which no one could count, from every nation and all tribes and peoples and tongues, doing what? Standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes and palm branches, which would symbolize peace, the white robes symbolizing their purity. These were in their hands, and they cry out with a loud voice, saying, "Salvation to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." Can you imagine what this vision would be? I asked AI, it's good for something. I just put this text in. I just straight in. Or I had Steve do it because I don't know how to do it. I just said, "Steve, since you pay for AI version, the fancy one, will you put this in there and just see what image comes out about this vision of the throne room with a multitude of all believers worshiping before the throne of God?" And this is what it says. You zoom it out. It's like, he said, make it bigger. Make the multitude bigger. And it zooms out further. Now, don't look at that as an AI image for a second. With the text and with a little bit of help, look upon this with the eyes of faith. And if you are in Christ, put yourself among that multitude. There's a day coming when all the sin and the suffering and the pain that we experience here will be no more. And we will stand before the throne of God above, in whose presence we don't deserve to be, but because his love fell upon us in a mighty way, because he redeemed us and saved us, we get to stand before him with all brothers and sisters from every nation for all time, worshiping, crying out with them, "Salvation to our God and to the Lamb." And what Jesus is going to point his disciples to, what he's going to point us to in this Luke 21, he says, hey, though you may be discouraged about what you're experiencing in this life, though it may seem like evil is winning, he's going to say this in Luke 21:28. He says, but when these things begin to take place, straighten up and lift your heads. Look to that day. Look to that day that you stand before the throne and before the Lamb with all the brothers and sisters for all times, worshiping in perfect peace and fullness of joy now and forevermore. Look to that day. Live by faith in that day. And though you may still live among those who reject and scoff at God, you can stand tall. Because in the same way that Jesus said Jerusalem would be destroyed, and it did, when he says he's coming back to vanquish evil, to completely abolish sin and to deliver to us the fullness of our salvation, you can be sure that it's coming. So don't live for this world. Don't get discouraged by this world. Live by faith that God, who has promised these things to us, will deliver upon them. This world is not our home, amen? That world is our home. Those who rule this nation, those who rules all the nations of the earth, God, they're there because God permits it, but they aren't the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Our God is, and our hope is in him. And so we rejoice in him, regardless of what we may see happening in the world and the culture around us. And so he says, straighten up and lift your heads because your redemption is drawing near. Don't give up. Don't fall away. Keep the faith. He then tells them this parable just to reinforce the certainty that this is going to happen. He says, behold, the fig tree and all the trees, as soon as they put forth leaves, you see it, and you know summer's near. And as readily as you can be confident that when the fig trees and all the trees from the death state of winter begin to bud out the leaves of life, as certain, and that way you know summer's coming, and the same certainty is that. When you see these signs that Jesus is talking about coming, don't be afraid. Do not be terrified. But stand up and lift your face because your redemption is drawing near. And with that redemption, the fullness of the kingdom of God itself. He says, when you see all these things happening, recognize that the kingdom of God is near. And then he says, truly I say to you, this generation will not pass away until all things take place. There's a ton of debate over what this generation means. What seems to make For me, the most logical sense is in the same way that he would talk about the generation of the scribes and the Pharisees, he is referring to this generation of kings and peoples who mock God and shake their fist at him. That generation is not going to pass away either until these things take place. But once these things take place, the generation of people who reject God will be gone, because he will return and the final judgment will come. He says, heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. So the point for this, and this is like the main idea of this morning, stand tall because you are redeemed in Christ by faith. Stand tall, not because you have confidence in the flesh, not because you're disciplined in your approach to religion and the spiritual disciplines. Stand tall. Why? Because you are redeemed in Christ by faith. Stand tall because who he is and what his sure promises are for you. You see, Jesus intends for a vision of the throne room of God to be something that does, in fact, give us courage and hope for every true believer in every day and in every time until this final judgment comes. And we must know that the end of this creation is the arrival of our life with God in the new creation. Our partial experience of the kingdom today will be transitioned to the fullness of our experience of his kingdom in the day that is to come. And so for now, though we see as though through a glass dimly, then we will see God and his kingdom and the new heavens face to face. And in the greatest day of fear for those who reject Christ, it is actually to us the day of the beginning of our greatest joy now and forever. Amen. But when it talks about the kingdom coming near, what will it be like? How often do you think about it? If the resurrection and life with God face to face in the new heavens is really the pinnacle of the hope of our promises that we have in God, what will it be like? In Revelation 7, again, as you keep going, after this multitude that we see from every tribe and tongue and nation praising God together before the throne, he then goes on to give a short description that you can read more about in Revelation 21 and 22 about what this kingdom is going to be like. And this is what it says, though, in Revelation 7, 15 through 17. It says, "For this reason, because they have been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, they are before the throne of God. And they serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will spread his tabernacle over them. And they will hunger no longer, nor thirst anymore. Nor will the sun beat down on them, nor any heat. For the Lamb, Jesus himself, in the center of the throne, will be their shepherd." You don't have to put up with us pastors anymore to get him directly. "And he will guide you to the springs of the water of life. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." Can you just imagine? Think about the moments in your life, whether it's present or something that's happened in the past, that have been the greatest moments of agony that you've ever experienced. Be it from suffering of sickness, or be it from the destruction of kind of your own life, of like a dog returns to its vomit. You keep going back to sin and you're just having such a hard time winning and walking in victory over it, or whether it's persecution from people that you love or people even that you don't know, but it's hard to endure and it brings about sorrow and suffering in your life. It's gone forever. And who is going to bring you perfect and complete comfort to relieve forever all the pain and sorrow that you ever experienced? Jesus Christ himself. It says here that God will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and I don't know exactly what that's gonna look like. But I've gotta believe that it is God himself who will come to all of his children and acknowledge the pain that they endured, acknowledge the fight that they had, the fight of faith that they had to endure in their life, and he himself will put his arm around you and will wipe away every tear that you've ever cried. And in that moment, it will be the end of your sorrow for all time and the beginning of perfect ever-increasing joy forevermore. Who wants some of that? Jesus is saying, straighten up and lift your face. Look to that day. Live for that day. Help others find that day. This world, if you try to find those kind of things here, it's always going to let you down. It's going to discourage you. It's going to put you in despair and depression. But that day, your hope is sure. All that God has promised to you, you will receive in full. It's hard to conceive, though, of it, right? Like, it's hard to imagine. So, again, I just took Revelation chapter 21 and then the first half of Revelation chapter 22 and got some help and put it into this AI generator. And I said, tell me what the new holy city will be like. It's described in Revelation 21. And this is what came. This is the city in which God will dwell. Some version of that that will be even far greater than what we're looking at, that the new Jerusalem will be large, and the center will be the very throne room of God from which he dwells. There will be no need for sun, for he himself will be our light as we live among him now and forevermore. And then from that throne proceeds the river of the water of life and the tree from which we will drink and be satisfied forevermore. And this is a picture of what that would be. But far greater, my oldest daughter was in here as we were kind of loading all these slides in, and this picture went up on the screen, and she stopped and she said, "Dad, that is beautiful." I said, "Oh, you just wait." And if you think about it, even right now, the earth itself is under a curse. Did you know that? And is groaning for redemption. What that means is that even the places that we stand in all of now will pale in comparison to the glory of the beauty of the new heavens and the new earth. I mean, imagine the places that we love to visit now. The Rockies of Colorado. Pick a place, any place. It's all just, it'll take your breath away. The beaches of 30A. I know many of you have the 30A sticker on the back of your car. So you make an annual pilgrimage there because you love the beach and the clear, beautiful water, the California coast or the Smoky Mountains, or if you're going international, any number of places. And none of these compare to the glory of the new creation that will grow no more, but itself will be redeemed and remade and made perfect. And it's the place that we will dwell to enjoy always with the heart of gratitude for God who has given us this new creation, and with, in the face-to-face kind of way, with God himself. And so Jesus says, when darkness falls, stand up and lift the eyes of your faith to this day. And what a day it will be. Amen? Here's some things I want you to consider with your family and with your community this week. As we think about standing before God, what is your confidence that you will be able to stand before the throne of God in peace? Not in fear, but in peace. When you stand before him, you will say, "You are my God, and I am your beloved child because of Jesus." What is your confidence? Second, do you ever experience doubt in your confidence to stand before God? Just to hopefully help the room about doubt, how many of you in this room have ever struggled with doubt as it relates to your faith? Just raise your hand so people know you're not alone, okay? You're not alone. And doubt is not a threat to your faith. It's an opportunity for you to reinforce your faith. It's an opportunity to go back and rehearse the gospel again, to remember why you believe what you believe. And so engage your doubt with the truth of the gospel. Don't fear it and run from it or be crippled by it. And then as you talk about with each other how you may be experiencing doubt, share with them how they can pray for you. And then third, how does a vision, you say, of the new heavens and the new earth strengthen you to endure now as you wait for the fullness of your salvation on that day? These are the things that Jesus is trying as a good shepherd to get us to ponder and to consider together as we see, or as we are discouraged by the world around us and as we see things proceeding from bad to worse. And so when darkness falls, stand up and lift your eyes of faith to this day that is coming that Jesus is pointing us to. And then Jesus transitions. And so he's anticipating his disciples' questions, saying, "How the, like, while we wait, as we wait with the eyes of faith, as we wait with our the anchor of hope being on this return of Christ and the arrival of the fullness of your salvation, like, how else should we live to endure as we do continue to live right now in a fallen world?" That's a good question, right? It's like, how do we survive? How do we not also live with discouragement? How do we deal with the strong current of the world that's always waging war against us? And Jesus goes on and he gives them words of practical advice. So this is Jesus himself right here in this text. He's gonna say, "My little children, this is what you are to do." Did y'all catch that? Jesus himself right here saying, "This is how you are to live while you wait on my return." And the first thing that he's gonna tell us, two things. The first thing that he's gonna say is this: guard against the entrapments of the world. Guard against the entrapments of the world. Verse 34, he says, "Be on guard." Again, when is he telling them this? In the span of his life, this is the night before his betrayal. This is the night before his last night. That's it. This is like final instructions. And he says, "Be on guard so that your hearts will not be weighed down with dissipation and drunkenness and the worries of life. And that day will not come on you suddenly like a trap, for it will come upon all those who dwell on the face of the earth." So think about it again. Not only is this the last 48 hours of his life when he's giving these instructions, he's not talking to the scribes and the Pharisees who he had constantly admonished all throughout, you know, his public ministry. He's not talking to pagan Gentile Romans who are godless and unruly in their own way of life. He's talking to Peter and to James and to John and the whole, you know, group of apostles. And so these are men who at this point have already shown, proven their devotion. But yet Jesus sees it fitting to them to say, "Be on guard. Your race is not over. And should you let your guard down, you will get swept up. So be on guard against the world and its temptations and these things that are gonna constantly be coming at you. And as you are on your guard, they won't overtake you. As you engage them by faith, you will be able to continue to stand." But basically, what he's telling them is that be on guard against the unholy trinity, the world, the flesh, and the devil. For these things will continually wage war against you. You're not gonna get a break. You have to wear the full armor of God even when you go to sleep. Like, be on guard at all times. And he gives a few examples. The word here for dissipation is a Greek word that refers to desire. And what he's saying is, like, there's gonna be a desire in your flesh for the world and for what the world could offer you. Comfort, riches, notoriety, affirmation, fleeting pleasure. And there is going to be something in your old man, so to speak, something in your flesh that's gonna desire these things. You need to be on guard against that. He's gonna go on and say, and drunkenness. Like, as you desire alcohol, it begins to take control for you. I think he used that as a specific example to make a broader point that it's not only alcohol that you have to worry about. It's anything that as you desire and you give yourself to will begin to control your life. You must be on guard against all these things. And then the big umbrella statement, and the worries of life. Be on guard against it. Who in here ever struggles with worry about life? Everybody should raise your hand. I'm not saying everybody who raises their hand lives, you know, defeated by the worries of life, but it all comes for all of us. And Jesus is saying, be on guard against these things. What's interesting, in Ephesians chapter 5, I think, when Paul talks about drunkenness specifically, He says, do not get drunk with wine, for that is dissipation. Same English word in our two translations, but it's a different Greek word. The Greek word in Ephesians is asatio, which means no salvation. Do not get drunk with wine, for that is no salvation. What you're looking for it to provide for you is not going to be a sufficient savior. And I believe Jesus is making a similar point here in some of his last words to his disciples, in these words to us today. Be on guard about looking for anything in this world to be your savior. For what you will find in it is no salvation. Where will you find that salvation? In Christ. And in the kingdom that is to come. And so be on guard against these things. And then he's going to go on, as you're to be on guard against the entrapments of the world, he knows that if we try to be on guard against these things in our own strength, we're not going to succeed. Like, we're not strong enough. How many of you have ever, post-profession of Christ, have backslidden and have sinned since that moment? Again, you should raise your hand. And if we continue to try to live and like, I'm just gonna do it. Like, I'm gonna overcome this. I don't need anybody's help. I'm just gonna do what the Lord tells me. And we just try to like white knuckle our way through our struggle, our war with sin, we're gonna fall. We can't do it on our own. And knowing that, what did Jesus, what's the second thing that he tells us to do? What's the second piece of practical advice that he gives us on how to live while we wait for his return? It's to pray. Pray for God to give you strength to endure. He says, keep on the alert at all times, praying that you may have strength to escape all these things that are about to take place and to stand before, there it is, to stand before the Son of Man. In one sense, you could say that it's our prayers through which we find strength from God that will enable us to stand before the Son of Man on that day. But what he's saying here is that we're to recognize daily that we don't have the strength to resist the world on our own, and therefore we should pray daily for God to give us strength to endure so that we can stand in confidence and peace and joy before the Son of Man. And so a couple more things for you to discuss amongst your family and your community this week. And being authentic, which means being real, being transparent. What entrapments of the world do you most need to be on guard against? What is it for you? I could list out 1,000 things up here, but what is it for you? And then just share with them, hey, this is where I'm most susceptible to looking for satisfaction and a false savior in the things of the world. And then secondly, where do you need God to give you strength so that you may endure in the faith and resist temptation? And as you share those things with each other, walk in then what Jesus is instructing us to do here and pray for each other. And believe that by faith, as we commune with the Lord and ask for him these things that we need in order to continue to persevere in the faith, that he with great joy will provide for us. Amen? You know, it's interesting, as I was looking at this practical advice from Jesus to us, at how strikingly similar what he's saying we need to be on guard against and what we need is to how he instructs us to pray in the Lord's Prayer. Like, where do we get strength from daily bread, both physically but also spiritually, as we commune daily with him who is the bread of life? You know, what's something that will divide us in our ability to stand in unison to help each other along in this life? Well, it's unforgiveness. What do we have to be on guard against? Well, it's the evil one. So, Lord, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. And then it ends with a recognition that his is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. A kingdom which we see now by faith, we experience now in part, but there's a day coming that we'll receive it in full. So I'd just love to end our time before we begin to sing, to respond in song together, by just praying exactly how Jesus taught us to pray and praying the Lord's Prayer together. And so I just want to take a moment and give you a second to just focus your mind and your heart on the Lord, and to consider, not just in some vague general way, but specifically for you, what when you say, give me this day my daily bread, give us. When you say, lead us not into temptation, what exactly for you is it specifically that you need the Lord to deliver you from? And then we'll recite the Lord's Prayer together, and then we'll stand and sing about He who is worthy. Let us pray. Our Father, who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and power and glory forever.